It's August 6th, 2017. You're listening to the Fancy Ramen Podcast. I'm Neil.
And I'm Scott.
And the selected track for today's intro music is the title screen music from the game The Letter from developer Yang Yang Mobile. Or maybe it's Yang Yang Mobile. I would love to credit the composer, but I actually couldn't find out what his or her name was. And I actually had a lot of trouble tracking down this song, so I had to rip it. Cookie's absent this week again, but he will be joining us through a recording a little later on.
Get well soon.
Wait, is he sick?
No, but I mean, he could always do better.
Hey man, your CS wasn't that good in ARAM the other day. Whatever.
No. He was doing great. I will say, for someone who hadn't been playing in that long a time, he was doing probably better than I would coming back into a game.
For someone who was still level 14, he was doing fantastic, like amazing, right?
Yeah, I've seen level 30s perform much worse than that.
So, oh man. When I saw the 14, I just was thinking to myself, oh, this could be rough.
And it was not. It actually worked out just fine.
But aside from playing some League of Legends ARAM with Cookie, which we might talk a little bit about later, Scott, what have you been doing lately?
Oh, not a huge amount. I've got some family in town, so I've been hanging out with them. I actually just finished hanging out with them before I got on to record here. But other than that, it's been same old this week, besides trying to put in some hard work on checking out that story mode for The Long Dark.
Both episodes 1 and 2, have you played both episodes at this point?
I've finished episode 1 and I'm in episode 2 now, and I love our podcast listeners, so I'll do my very best to finish episode 2. But it's tough.
And why is it tough?
It's tough because the game kind of sucks. It's really disappointing. Like, I still adore this game completely for its sandbox mode, but this story mode is like a dumpster fire. It's not fun. I spent a bunch of time trying to finish episode 1 in time for recording because I was kind of busy earlier in the week, and so I committed a bunch of time to finish it up yesterday, and I started episode 2 and did just a little bit of it and went, no, you know what? I deserve some time to enjoy myself. I'm going to go do something that I actually like. So I turned off the Long Dark and went and did literally anything else and felt happy about it.
When you think about a game that has, or that's known for its open world sandbox experience, quote unquote, like Morrowind or Oblivion, the stories in those games aren't necessarily great, but it doesn't usually deter, at least for people that enjoy those games, their experiences, right? How is this story mode any worse? Like, how does it negatively affect the entire experience? Because it sounds like it's worse than just having a bad story.
Right, because we know what bad story is for a open world kind of game. You're the chosen whatever, and you're going to do this thing that's going to help the land, and you have some special attribute that makes you better than every other piece of shit NPC that exists in this universe. But also no rush. Take it at your own pace, you know? The world's ending, but we could hang on for a while, so do your thing. Like, that's how we can say generically every Bethesda open world game is, right? So Fallout 3, Fallout New Vegas, all the Elder Scrolls I've played, you have some important thing that needs to be done, but you go ahead and do it on your time. You know, nobody's forcing you to progress the story forward, and so you can explore and enjoy the world at your convenience, right?
Right.
Yeah, in The Long Dark with this story mode, it starts off as a tutorial, which is good because there are players who will be playing the game for the very first time, have not done anything in Sandbox, probably just bought the game, and so they do need to learn how to play the game. It's annoying for someone like me who already knows what he's doing, but has to be forced to like break my wrist and then heal it using some like painkiller tea that I've made through rose hips. But so be it. It's a short enough period of time that it's not a big deal. But it's scripted really poorly. A lot of people have been encountering glitches, myself included. I've run into a couple of problems. And if it weren't just for the tutorial being kind of burdensome and annoying for someone who's already played the game, it also seems brutally unfair at some other points in time just during the beginning that I'm thinking, okay, they started it off easy enough, and then all of a sudden they put the player into a situation, or at least in my case, into a situation with shitty wolf AI that keeps me from progressing almost at all. Like, I almost died in the very beginning because I went from dealing with one wolf that was attached to me by like a rubber band, like would keep running away and then fleeing right back at me down a trail, to a wolf ambush bridge, which anti-Mackenzie homing wolves just followed me from car to car as I tried to get across. It's bad.
Anti-Mackenzie homing wolves.
Your character's name is Will Mackenzie, and these wolves are like, oh my God, they're unavoidable. I thought that I encountered one wolf, and then all of a sudden I have two stalking me, and I hop in a car, and then one of those wolves moves away, and I move a little bit further down, and it seems like another wolf has just spawned in the middle of the bridge. And so I'm trying to like cross this bridge without getting wolf aggro, but as soon as I leave a car, the wolf that I see that's walked 50 feet away just immediately turns around and starts pacing right back towards me. It's it's like they're literally glued to your character and can't leave a certain radius on you. And it's just, it was total bullshit. It made me waste like, I don't know, like 30 minutes in game trying to progress maybe 100, 150 feet. What I ended up doing was leaving little like meat decoys all around the vehicles, but as soon as I'd leave, the wolf would be, it would leave the meat decoy and immediately target back to me. So these were specially bred wolves meant to only kill Will Mackenzie, Canadian bush pilot. Oh man, as far as the story goes, we don't expect much for a story for an open world game, but this is a linear game that you can explore a little bit in, and it has a crappy story at that. So with the open world games, there's normally a lot of content and things to explore and see and do that will keep you entertained and interested and excited about the game. And in this game, it's like this kind of small corridor with anti-Mackenzie wolves everywhere and a really shitty story that you more or less have to complete the fetch quests for in order to progress forward. The first character you meet, oh, go ahead, please.
So doesn't it seem like one of the issues with that is every open world game we have that has some form of plot or story, it relies on having a cast of characters to create that plot.
Right, but when you're in the quiet apocalypse, everybody's supposed to be dead. So your interesting characters are limited, but good thing the writers decided that they would add a really interesting character. And that's an old blind lady who can't do anything, and so you have to take care of her.
What was she doing before you get there? Was she in the plane?
No, so you find this small town called Milton. Oh, that's the other thing, too. The story starts off just excellently with you sitting in your like office with a bottle of Canadian Club or whatever whiskey you've got, and you're drinking away your sorrows, and your ex-wife comes in. You don't know that it's your ex-wife, but the writing's bad enough that you can infer that the worst thing to do would be to have that character be your ex-wife, and it turns out that it is. And so you have to fly her, no questions asked whatsoever, to some place on Great Bear Island, which is where all the sandbox and story maps are located. And your plane crashes because of the Aurora Borealis or something like it. And you stroll into town and find this blind old lady called the Gray Mother. And who knows why she's called that. And she's very hostile to you because you're an outsider. You're a mainlander.
And a man to boot.
And a man, yeah. And she's got a rifle pointed at you. She's blind, but she can still shoot you to death. So, yeah, she'll hear if you have any have any wily thoughts about trying to get the best of her. So, you meet the Grey Mother. She tells you that, oh, I'm sitting here in my rocking chair, completely blind, but I can shoot you dead. But I'm about to run out of wood, so get me like 30 units of wood for this. And by 30 units, it's like I took every single piece of wood I could find in this goddamn town and put it into her fire bin and then some. And she's like, okay, that's enough. That'll get me through the winter. Now I'm hungry. Go and find me food. So after I spent all this time foraging and dodging wolves to get the wood, now I have to go and get some food. And I ate a bunch of food in the town so I could run around and grab the wood. And now I've got to backtrack to get more food. And so it's like really bad pairing of the fetch quests as well. If we could get both of them at the same time, firewood and food, I could have managed my resources better. But I'm still able to get her food. And then she decides to tell me about my friend and where she may have gone. And earlier you're tracking your ex-wife or... I don't know what to... We're going to call her Astrid because that's the character's name. But Will switches between acknowledging that like he has a past relationship with her and then just saying, well, my friend, my passenger. But she goes ahead and she hints that, oh, maybe your passenger is up this way. And it comes to turn out that I had already gone that way, seen the torn piece of clothing that was supposed to be hers, been unable to interact with it because William McKenzie, unless he's told that that's her scarf after telling the lady that's what the scarf looks like, he has no idea. He can't acknowledge it or notice it. So I finish the stupid fetch quests. I go back to the spot that I already knew she was at and a cutscene triggers. And then now I have to go back to her and she makes me run around town again, grab a lockbox key from a farmhouse I had already looted, and then go to a bank that I had already looted and get key items from there that probably don't spawn until the quest is triggered. And then I have to, every time after I unlock this next step for her too, she needs to like sit and wait. She's like, oh, I need to rest and be with my thoughts. So I spend a day sleeping inside a house waiting, dodging wolves or healing up from the last wolf I fought off.
No, you know what? That sounds about right. This sounds
no,
realistic
it's
so far.
So stupid. Oh, God, I hate it. And so finally, I find out that my friend has left town and that I've righted the wrong that the Grey Mother wants me to right. And I should say that I'm spoiling all of this, but it's a god-awful story, so I really don't feel bad. But I right the wrong that the Grey Mother's daughter didn't get buried with her pearls. And so I go and rob the pearls from the bank and put it on her daughter's grave. And so she gives me her daughter's climbing rope and map, and I go the back way through the mountains. But first I have to tell her that the tunnel's closed off. And she's like, oh, well, that was my only chance for survival. And I'm like, good, give me your gun and all your food that I collected for you and let me get the fuck out of here. But no, she decides that she's going to keep the gun and the food and the firewood that I spent all that time collecting and give me a shitty rope that's going to break when I try and climb down the mountainside.
It actually breaks or broke.
It does break. Yeah, it's a super old rope. Like, I don't know how long her daughter's been dead, but it's been a while. And so I have this like old moldy rope that just snaps while I'm trying to climb down. And then I think you sustain an injury, but it was like minor bruising, so it didn't actually do anything, but an injury pop-up came just to tell me that I landed on my ass or something.
Oh, getting the laughs that way?
I mean, I didn't find it funny. I was just like, I was so pissed at that point because I had spent 6 hours drudging around a town with wolves that were literally like looking for me and me only. And I had issues with the wolves too. I had issues with that wolf I told you earlier who was rubber banded to me. I scared it away from a deer carcass and wolf growling sounds were coming out of the deer carcass, even though the wolf was like fleeing 150 feet away. This game should not have been released in this condition. This is releasing a broken game. No doubt about it. And so I had that issue with the wolves, and then I had another wolf like teleport through a house to attack me. I couldn't see him, but I could hear him growling, and then all of a sudden he ran through like a completely wooden wall and jumps me, and I'm just like, what the fuck, ghost wolf? How do I fight these? So that's more or less the end of, I think, the first... You find a cave after you climb down to that next area and do some exploring. And I gotta say, like, the level building, the scenery is really cool. I can't wait to play it in the sandbox. I really like the town that they made. And they did a really good job with kind of constructing the environment. But the AI and the quests spoil all of it. And so when I started episode 2, which starts with a really weird cutscene where just all of a sudden I see a man being attacked by a bear in a snowy field, and I have no idea how I got there, and then my character picks up and shoots the gun, and then all of a sudden I wake up in the trapper's lodge of the bear guy who is getting attacked is the trapper, Jeremiah. I find myself in his lodge, so somehow I've drug his body there, not knowing where it is at all, and this is a location that I'm familiar with in the game, and I'm like, where the fuck did you find this cabin if this guy was unconscious? Like, you couldn't have just known it was up ahead. And so, through some sort of plot magic, we appear in his cabin, and he's beaten half to death, so I've got to travel all over the map to get him antibiotics and supplies, and now he's determined on me killing that bear before I go anywhere else.
But you're still playing as Will McKenzie, then.
Neil, I'm not having fun. I loved this game, and this story mode is everything it takes to ruin it for me.
So it's been that bad that you don't even enjoy playing the sandbox at this point, or have you not tried the sandbox?
I haven't played the sandbox, but I'll try and finish the episode because I want to be able to give full and cohesive thoughts about all of it. And I'm already committed enough to it that I might as well stick it out.
Sure.
But... man, it sucks. Yeah, I would, if this was the only way to play the game was the story mode, I would hate this game and I would probably not try another game like it ever again. I would just decide like, this isn't my genre. So I'll go back to the sandbox, and I bet it's going to feel really nice to not have someone telling me what to do or where to go. And the shitty animal AI is easier to deal with when you're playing sandbox, and so you can just walk away from a problem and deal with it later. Oh, that was the other thing too, is the thing that I really loved about The Long Dark is the environment's a really big issue too. Like, not just the wolves, but finding food and shelter and avoiding, you know, blizzards and things like that, or low fog visibility. Very little of the environmental or weather issues occurred, and all the places in the first episode are so well stocked because you have to be feeding the Grey Mother that it doesn't have any of that thrill or excitement that the survival mode in the sandbox does. And so that's the other thing too, is like the fun elements of it are toned down or completely removed so you can do the story mode with some level of efficiency.
I half expected you to say at one point during this conversation that the Grey Mother turns out to be a ghost. Would have been
if
better,
she was a
right?
ghost, I wouldn't have to feed her and give her wood. Yeah.
Yeah, you would have found all of it there, presumably.
Yeah. I could have taken it with me, yeah. And I could have looted her for her daughter's broken rope anyway.
Like, when she disappears, man. The apparition of the Grey Mother disappears. It turns out that her chair is now just stacked with wooden food that you place there.
And who the hell calls themselves the Grey Mother in third person? This is a make Canada great again type of individual, as far as I know. But I don't care if you're some backwoods lady. You don't speak about yourself in some mystical third person. It just doesn't make any sense to me.
Who then seemingly gives up on her life because a tunnel has collapsed?
But she's blind, so I mean, and she can't get herself wood or meat. She can just shoot strangers who walk in her door.
So how else was she able to survive before you?
Until then, exactly. It's bad story writing, Neil. It's really bad story writing because there are so many things that I'm just like, what the hell is this about? Or I don't understand it. And then the other half is just like, wow, this is really dumb. I really don't like how you set this story up or the reasoning behind it.
Right.
A lot of the dialogue initially with your wife is just like, with your ex-wife, I should say, is like, oh, it's been a long time. Haven't seen you in a while. You still doing whatever with that one person? I don't want to talk about it. Well, what about, don't bring that up. Bring what up? Like, it's just a bunch of non sequitur allusions to I don't know what. I think I'm going to call it right now, but the first episode has something about losing a child is like losing your own life. And even before we got to that point, I was just like, oh, it seems to me like they had a child and lost it. So I'm thinking like miscarriage or loss of like an older child to some sort of accident. And there's blame between the two of them. That's what it feels like. But you'd never know because they'll never bring anything up. They don't actually talk to each other in the way any human being would. Ugh, it's hackneyed and it's histrionic and it's really fucking annoying. I will say really quickly, the thing that upset me the most about The Long Dark is I thought it was going to be better because of the talent they brought on for their voice actors. I don't know how familiar you are with voice actors in video games, but you've played Metal Gear Solid games, and so you probably know David Hayter because he plays Solid and Naked Snake. And then you also know about Deus Ex, and that had Elias Tufexis, and he's angry, angsty cyborg Adam Jensen. And then we have both Commander Shepherds in The Long Dark as well, Mark Meer and Jennifer Hale. And the voice acting cannot save the bad storyline, which is really sad because all of those voice actors I really like, besides maybe Adam Jensen's, I don't know much about him. But it was sad. It was sad to play a game that was just not there, like not a product I would ever feel comfortable releasing if I were the developers.
Did you notice that before the official release, any of the specific voice actors you mentioned?
Before the release of the game, did I know they were going to be in it?
No, but you had voiced, didn't you have voice actors for the game before its official release?
Yeah, I think Jennifer Hale is the female character, or what's her name, Astrid, in the game.
Okay.
And then I guess I never placed it, but I'm pretty sure it's Mark Meer who plays the male character, William McKenzie. And I wouldn't have recognized him as Commander Shepard, because I think he does a slightly more gravelly voice for Commander Shepard, or it's more commanding at least. Yeah, man, that game's killing me right now. I should also say that the animation, though, it's a really small studio. Hinterlands is like, it's really not that many people, but it is quite a few like AAA developers and programmers, and they did a really good job with the animation. Except for the fact that after the initial animation, you go into a Fallout 4 or Mass Effect style dialogue wheel, but then it's all just solid subtitle text and they stand still all of a sudden. It's really jarring the first time you see it, and then afterwards you're just like, well, whatever, you
know. Oh wait, it's not in first person all the time?
No, it's not. It splits to third person, and or not third person even, it splits to like an animated scene for certain dialogue portions, and it's animated really well. Actually, I think it's really quite good. But then it just flips back to like a first person view, I think, or maybe it still has just like kind of a pan view that has both your character and the other NPC that you're talking to in the shot, and it alternates between the shots as you pick the different standard dialogue questions: bus, map, mountain range, stuff like that. And then the initial cutscenes, the one with Will McKenzie and his ex-wife, and when they're in the office, and then when they're in the plane, are really weird because it's like almost 2D at points, and because of the art style, it looks papery, but in a really shitty way, not in the cool way that Paper Mario has always been able to capitalize on, but like a very uncanny valley sort of way. Like I saw a wrist bend, but it looked more like twisting paper, and it was upsetting to see.
Interesting.
Yeah, but that's it. I'm done hating on The Long Dark. I'm going to go enjoy sandbox mode again and maybe finish up the second episode if I'm feeling masochistic. But I can't see any reason to be motivated to play the third, fourth, or fifth episodes.
Will they be free?
Yes, they should be free to anybody who bought the game. And if they change that, I'll be pissed. Because they shouldn't be. They should really not be charging for the type of episodes that they're putting out. The content that they're putting out does not match with what the price tag is.
You mentioned a small team, that it's a small team that developed this game. And part of me starts to wonder, too, if it's similar to what kind of failed No Man's Sky, in that the staff did not have a writer. So all of the flavor text, which more or less serves as the majority of the story, in a way that you could argue or say is similar to like Dark Souls, but not at all to that quality, mind you.
It should be. That would be a better way to do it, as opposed to bribing Grey Mother with rabbit skins until she decides you're trustworthy enough to tell you random shit.
What I'm wondering is if the poor story is at fault because of a weak, or like not having a primary writer on staff.
Well, their writer was a writer for Mass Effect 3 as well, and some other games.
I think you may have just...
I may have solved the problem right there. I think he was the writer for the last 10 minutes of Mass Effect 3.
I'm going to jump to the news for just a second.
We should.
This is kind of old news, but I'm looking it up right now. I really didn't necessarily feel like it was important enough to talk about last
but
week.
But now it's relevant. Yeah.
Yeah, but Casey Hudson, who was the the general manager of BioWare during the Mass Effect days, who had left after Mass Effect 3, actually has just returned to BioWare as of 2 weeks ago or so.
BioWare hasn't put out anything that I've really enjoyed since first half of Mass Effect 3. I haven't enjoyed Dragon Age that much. I can't think of anything else they've done that's been that exciting. Certainly Andromeda is, it is a pile of shit.
I kind of want to play it once it drops down to a low enough amount of money that I would not feel, you know, cheated.
That you wouldn't feel bad about it, yeah. It would have to be a low price for me because at one point in time on a Steam sale, I got Oblivion and all of its DLCs for $5. And I mean, I don't care how much the game's aged graphically. I enjoyed that game enough. And that was a killer deal. And I think that Mass Effect Andromeda would have to match something like that to get me to play it.
And I've read a lot of the poor reviews of that game. And I'm just wondering how much of it is actually that bad and how much is just a lot of negative press involving googly eyes.
Yeah, I mean, I just remember watching the gameplay videos and some of the demo plays and deciding that that was enough reason to stop watching the video even, let alone play the game. So
Mass Effect 3 played really well. So even if the story is shit, the ending leaves a bit to be desired, even if you're a indoctrination theory believer.
Like, which you should be, because it's the only way to, I feel like, recover some of the story. But yeah, I see what you're saying. The gameplay was really good. The multiplayer of it, if there was a game that was just like that for multiplayer that had a little bit more, had a little more flesh on it, had a little bit more for content, then I probably would buy a game like that.
Yeah.
So games can be good if they have good gameplay elements, but especially in like The Long Dark, if your gameplay is really good, don't destroy it with some other element. Don't take it away at the expense of something that you can't do as well. Well, what do you want to talk about? Because I've had enough griping.
All I've really been doing is playing The Letter at this point and house hunting. Hopefully that doesn't go on much longer, because I feel like house hunting takes up a good 10 to 12 hours of my week every week now.
I mean, it is a task that requires a good amount of attention if you want it done right and you don't want to regret any mistakes later.
So opening up the hot pot officially now. Let's start off with pre-orders for the SNES Classic, which will be commencing this month in North America.
Woo!
Yeah, more on that in a bit. Next up, we have three games that were announced involving Persona, all spin-offs, of course. Persona Q2, which is going to be a lead-up of Persona Q. Assumedly for the... Oh, actually, I believe they said it was for the Vita and PlayStation 4.
Interesting, because Persona Q is Nintendo, which was interesting.
I still haven't played Persona Q yet, and I'm not sure if I'll get around to it, because I'm not necessarily a huge fan of the Etrian Odyssey series.
Gotcha. And it's similar to that. My sister's played it, and she liked it, but she said it doesn't necessarily stack up to the quality you expect out of a console version of Persona.
But we can't forget they had an amazing pre-order bonus, which was a tarot deck from the Persona 3 and 4 games.
Which is really cool, yeah.
So if they brought in a Persona 5 tarot deck, I don't like that deck nearly as much as 3 and 4, but you know, I might get it just for that. That's a terrible
choice. You don't like the tarot deck for 5?
I like it, just not as much.
I don't know what the tarot deck for 4 looks like, but I thought the tarot deck for 3 wasn't anything super exciting either.
It's just the nostalgia factor, you know? I'm pretty sure it was the same for 3 and 4, so I got so used to it by the time I'd played 3 and 4 over multiple times.
Yeah, I definitely prefer 5 over 4.
If 5 has a lot of personality to it, but like especially because every tarot card is so fucking bleak looking.
Yeah, they all have some sort of like death or demise element to them. Almost every single one. It's a very sadistic looking deck, honestly. And the old decks are a lot more colorful and they have their own kind of style for sure, but they're definitely a lot more neutral in tone in a lot of ways.
Yeah, absolutely.
Where the Persona 5 deck, like it would be hard to look at any of those cards and not have some sort of a negative perception about it or about what it's implying.
Along with Persona Q2, we have Persona 5 Dancing Star Knight and Persona 3 Dancing Moonlight.
One of those is a very stupid name, and it's Dancing Star Knight.
I kind of think they're both stupid.
Dancing Moonlight makes slightly more sense.
Star Knight, Moonlight, like these are both very Japanese English names to begin with.
What's funny about them is that they all still keep the rhyming schema working for Personas 3 through 5 now.
Except it's not even technically rhyming with Persona 5. They just replaced star or all with star.
Yeah, but I mean, it's not as bad as slant rhyming.
What's slant rhyming?
Slant rhyming is when you use something that's close, but not exactly a phonetic copy. So, I can't come up with anything on the spot, but it wouldn't actually have an ite sound. It would sound very close to an ite sound.
Wait. Vowel rhyming instead? Because I always felt that was just as acceptable. Maybe not in rap, where I'm assuming the phonetic rhyming is that much more important. But let's say you ended a line in fight and then said, oh, God, I don't know an example. Now
I know, it's tough because there are so many things that actually rhyme that have that ite ending that it's difficult. But the slant rhyme definition is in which either the vowels or the consonants of stressed syllables are identical. So eyes and light, years and yours, like that's a slant rhyme, also known as a half rhyme, imperfect rhyme, near rhyme, oblique rhyme, or an off rhyme. Thank you, thesaurus.com. Yeah, but moving on from that, I haven't played a .hack GU game, but there's one coming out that you're interested in?
Yeah, so basically, CyberConnect 2, that's the company that was working on the Final Fantasy VII remake. And they kind of dramatically were dropped from the project when Squaresoft basically announced that they were going to be more hands-on with their first-party content or their licenses. And immediately afterwards, CyberConnect2 announced that they were working on .hackGU Recode, which was originally, as I thought, a remake of the .hackGU series, which were a trilogy on the PlayStation 2. But after we've seen some new screenshots and some more information has come out, we have a release date in Japan, which is November 1st, 2017. And we also know now that the game is not only a remake, but it also expands upon the ending with assumedly another chapter to the game. If we're being really optimistic, we're going to be looking at a fourth part, so maybe as long as one of those three parts, although this will all be in one game, so presumably another 30% longer. What makes me think that is because it includes a transformation for the main character. Kind of spoilers if you haven't played .hackGU, or if you want to stay completely pure to GU, you should probably stop listening now or skip ahead a couple minutes. But basically, the main character goes through multiple transitions. It's the game's an MMO, or about an MMO, and his character class has transformations. And he has four transformations in the core game, and this one now has a fifth transformation. So I'm assuming they're putting on a decent amount of content to justify that additional transformation. For anyone looking into it that doesn't know about GU, it's just an anime-as-fuck game. And the .hack series as a whole is known as being technically not, but the original Sword Art Online. It's basically a game or series in which people are playing this VR, this MMO in VR goggles. And if a bug happens that I won't talk about, you might end up in a coma and within the game and in real life. And so the original .hack series is about trying to figure out why people are falling into a coma. And GU is kind of the same thing, except there's a lot more attention paid to the story and character developments and so forth. And it gets maybe a little more complicated.
So have you looked at the new screenshots that have released for it?
Yeah, and they look anime as fuck and good.
They do, until the very last screenshot I saw, where it shows, I think, your main player character in kind of an, I don't know, it's in a dungeon-esque kind of room, and it looks like there's a merchant at the back. But it looks like some really high-quality PS3 graphics in that particular image. But in the rest of them, I'll agree, it does look really nice on that kind of cutscene or animation graphics.
This game, much like Final Fantasy X, had this, and I think for that matter, 12 as well. I believe that was the next single-player Final Fantasy game. Had this whole gimmick where you basically had two versions of every character model. One which was your high fidelity, super great looking character model, and then another one which is like, oh, if the camera angle is going to be a ways back, it's not going to, the hyper detail isn't going to necessarily matter.
We don't need to render all those freckles.
Yeah, exactly. And going through the screenshots, I totally see when those character models are being used. It's very recognizable when those lower res models are being implemented or used. So I understand. It seems like the core structure of the game remains the same. I don't know. This is totally a fanboy trying to justify a flaw in the game or trying to say that it's okay. That's how it was like in the original.
No, I get it. I mean, I own the Shadow of the Colossus HD remake, the first one before the next one's coming out. But it's one of those where it was still kind of angular and pretty polygonal. So it was a little bit prettier, but not by a huge amount. And if it's a really good game, sometimes it doesn't matter.
Yeah. You can look at some of the details in the background, too, and look at how the textures really don't look that great, and based on the texture, you would almost want there to be more polygonal shapes. Like, this brick wall should really actually extend a little more at the brick and not so much at the mortar.
Right. It does look like it's a lot of textures kind of pasted onto a very flat surface.
Yeah, exactly.
But moving forward, is there anything in the upcoming weeks that you're excited about, Neil?
I think we will both be excited for, whenever it may be, it's sometime in August, Earth Mode returning to League of Legends.
But Neil, what does Earth stand for?
Well, Earth, before I get into the definition of Earth, or at least in this use, Earth was a manatee character in League of Legends, kind of like a joke champion that got canceled. Maybe it was never in development. Who really technically knows? Earth, in this case, stands for Ultra Rapid Fire. Long story short, this is just when every character in League of Legends is basically broken, turned into hyper ultra power mode, if you will. In that case, everyone is overpowered, but in doing so, it creates a hellish lot of fun.
Yeah, it does. Oh man. I am pretty excited. This should be a total blast. For Earth Mode, if anybody who plays League now and hasn't played during an Earth Mode, they're missing out on probably one of my favorite things. It's like ARAMs on speed, honestly. And it's also on the it's on the 5v5 regular map as well. Summoner's Rift. They take away mana and energy costs for champions, and cooldown reduction on everything is 80%. And so it's just crazy. There are a lot of champions that, like, their mechanics are fun, but they're not broken because they have a long enough cooldown to make sure that you're not abusing their powers. Earth Mode kind of eliminates that entirely. And so what's really fun about this is finding a champion that has an ability that you just want to mash. Like when you're playing Ryze normally and you can mash Q, but now let's say it's Blitzcrank and you can use the rocket pull every couple of seconds. This is what makes it so much fun, is just because it gets into some really wacky gameplay. And I can't wait to play it this year. Because I missed it last year, and I'm still kicking myself about that a little bit.
I wonder, I've got a few friends that play League as well, and I'm wondering if they'd be willing to come back if just for Earth.
Have them come back for a victory lap in Earth Mode.
We have one email today, and Cookie, who was unable to join us, Cookie is actually going to read this one off and offer his reply first, and then we'll cue in.
And give the complete counterpoint.
Hello, possible lady and gents. I'm catching up on this high sodium noodle fest, and I have to ask, given the recent craze and hysteria of mini SNESs, it doesn't seem like there's a lot of love for the mini NES. So why the change of heart for this SNES? And yes, we know it won't exist. Dave. I'm so glad Dave is back and still in existence and still kind of keeping up with this. So, at least me with the SNES, I don't really have that much love for it because of the NES and with its non-existence and the whole grab bag and the member berries. I know you and Scott might have a little more member berries with the SNES, but I didn't have all of those, like, great memories with it. My first primary console was the Nintendo 64. Yeah, we did have the SNES, but I wasn't playing much of it. I remember a lot for the 64, so when that eventually gets released and announced, because you know it will, I'll probably be a lot more hyped for that, depending on what games are released for that. As for the SNES Classic, I know my wife wants one, so I'm going to try and get one. Fingers crossed, but besides that, I've got the feeling that I'll touch it once and never touch it again, like pretty much every other thing I've got.
The reason for me that the Super Nintendo Entertainment System is getting more of a positive reaction and excitement from me is because this is really when I started as a gamer. Like, this was the first introduction to playing video games in my own home on my first console, and it happened around the same time I got a Game Boy Color, so those two kind of worked in tandem. But the Super Nintendo is like, that is the ultimate good feels type of games that I like to still go back to this day and play some more, because they totally bring me back to my childhood. And even if it is, you know, like rose-colored glasses when I play these games, it feels so good to go back and enjoy them. So the Super Nintendo Mini coming out has me excited because I can do that with even more games. And it totally does have me kind of on the, what was it? The member berries. Yeah, they're totally capitalizing on that feeling for me. But, you know, that's why I want to purchase it too, is so I can reminisce and enjoy the old days and those old games again on something that I'm less worried about breaking in the next couple times I turn on the power button. Every time I turn on my Super Nintendo or like I make a move, I just cross my fingers that it doesn't like break or die. Because it's not like I can just buy a new one.
Like even if you did on eBay, it sounds like there's a number of resources are available for you to fix your SNES. And that seems to indicate that buying an SNES on eBay or used usually isn't always a surefire success.
Yeah.
But I think you nailed it. It's a matter of like age demographic. How old are the people that started playing SNES as their first console? You know, they're probably anywhere
between their 20s.
Yeah, their 20s, their late 20s, early 30s. And these are the people that are in the perfect age, I think, to look back and say, hey, I could totally buy this thing for $80.
Yeah, no, it really is a great timing for that market. And I think it still will be if they do a N64 Mini.
I also think, absolutely. I also think that this is the age demographic that starts to have way more computer, not only literacy, I guess, computer tech savvy, whatever.
But also interest.
Like this demographic or this age group is also one that uses online communication much more. And I think that we perceive the SNES getting a lot more hype because we read about it and all of these things online. Like, I actually don't mean to turn this into a weird conversation. We get almost all of our media at this point through an online means like Reddit or game journalism or even regular like online journalism. It's
Shit,
all online.
Even Twitter has the news that some people get.
Yeah, exactly. And so like the people that grew up with the Atari, for instance, I've got a sound console called Otari. Even the people that, you know, would find that nostalgia in the Atari that were, you know, are probably in their mid 40s at this point, maybe. Or like
probably still
30s.
Watch cable news and get their information maybe from a newspaper as well.
Yeah, or like at least they're probably less likely to be involved with Twitter and Reddit and those online forums, if you will.
Right.
So I think it's also a level of perceived interest. Oh wait, but like maybe I don't know. I wanted to say that too, but I guess like Dave's question was more pointed just at our personal interests, huh?
Yeah, but and we tackled that I'm explaining why for mine. When the N64 rolls around, I won't be interested. I have an N64. I'm less worried about it breaking, and I have all the games for that I like and still want to play.
If you have questions, comments, or corrections, like this last email, you can write us in at podcast@fancyramen.com or leave a comment below if you're with us on YouTube. And if you're enjoying the show, leave a review for us on Apple Podcasts, iTunes, your favorite podcasting service. But more importantly, tell a friend and help us grow our audience.
I know our audience grows by word of mouth the most. And so that is definitely the most helpful and beneficial thing that can be done for us.
Any closing words before we end this glorious podcast, Scott?
God, I can't remember if I said during earlier episodes, like, the Long Dark's great. You should really try it out. Plus, the story mode's coming out, so that's going to be really cool. I'm really wondering about that now. If you're going through our episodes backwards, because some people do that, ignore past Scott. If the sandbox mode is not for you, save yourself. Get out of here. Don't play the Long Dark.
Are you issuing an apology?
I'm issuing an apology to anyone who bought the game with the intent of enjoying most of it through the story mode and not through the sandbox. If anybody picked it up because they thought the sandbox was interesting, I still don't think they're going to be disappointed. There's no reason to. But and anybody who picked up the story mode or the game primarily for that, you have been warned. I am a big proponent of the sandbox. I really loved that part of the game. The long dark story mode is hot garbage that I don't want to even look at on my computer. It wounds me to boot the game and see Wintermute on the first panel and not survival mode.
Wintermute.
Wintermute's the name of this first season with episodes 1 and 2. Yeah.
Oh God, they're gonna have a second season. And
yeah,
people will presumably buy it.
Oh God, yeah. And if my first impression is anything to go on, you know, thank goodness that... Well, actually, no. Quick question. You played Life is Strange, and Life is Strange was sold episodically, correct?
Yeah.
So would you be happier, or would you prefer that something like The Long Dark sold at a cheaper price and you could episodically buy the upcoming chapters or seasons while still having the base game for like the sandbox mode and say episode 1, but then you had to pay for episodes 2, 3, 4, and 5 later, like you had to do with, oh my God, I already forgot the name of it.
Life is Strange?
Life is Strange, yeah. Would you prefer that? Because I know right now I definitely would if they did that with games more often. If they parsed them out into a fair price for each component, which I doubt that would ever happen, or it would be very easy to do, but man, that would be such a benefit.
I think, though, as soon as you implement that, you automatically get people wanting to just buy a season pass at a reduced cost, right?
Right, so. And it at a certain point, it might seem a little microtransaction-y if you have to buy each part of a story's content.
If the pre-order price for the game was... What was the price before they hiked it up?
Before they hiked it up, it was $20.
So if they charged $20 for the base game in episode 1, and then charged however much after for each episode, what's the total of the game for the game?
It's 35 now. So you could say that it's 15 for episodes 3, 4, and 5 when they come out.
Yeah.
And you pay 20 for the base. If I would have known that, yeah, I would have definitely said that maybe paying the 20 was more than the fair share for the game. At least considering the story mode. If I would have played episode 1 and had an option to purchase episode 2, I would have not purchased episode 2. I would have immediately quit at that point.
But now, just by the nature, even though you're getting these for free at this point, because you bought the game before the price
right
hike, it now at some weird logical or not or illogical means devalues your purchase because you've now spent $10 on that story content.
Yeah, when I could have spent $10, I should have bribed the developers and said, no story mode, we just need moose.
I hope they release the moose and charge you for it.
Oh my God.
$2 for moose to appear in your game.
What's next?
I've had a great time recording episode 27 with you today, Scott.
It's been a pleasure, Neil. Until next time.